Greetings, Guardians. My name is Law Daddy here. That's the last time you're going to hear that, probably, because it's about to be the end of the period over which I was supposed to say that. Yeah, I know, all good things must come to an end. Today I wanted to talk a little bit about something that thankfully isn't going to happen. I'm going to talk very briefly about what might have happened if the Endless Night hadn't been stopped and if the Vex simulation was to play out in its entirety. Needless to say, the answer to this question is all the scarier given that we now know the Endless Night was tied to Savathun and was the work of Coria. There are a few moments where we can go beyond simply guessing as to what would have happened. I think it should also be noted that the entire question is, of course, by its very nature, a little speculative, even if we are taking into account some sources. And that's going to count doubly for some of the sources because, well, we're mentioning Truth to Power in this, so yeah. And in the other source in question, a certain character calls it a bunch of lies. So we're not entirely sure is a very good yardstick to use when answering this question. But I think regardless of what the answer may or may not have been, I feel as though these potential answers still give us a terrifying and important glimpse into the potential power of our enemy. One thing I am going to steer away from in this particular video, because it's not mentioned as much and I don't believe it to be something which can truly be speculated on, is the idea of whether the city might have ended up taken. This is of course something that we've seen before. The Dreaming City has been effectively taken and is stuck in that curse cycle, and it's entirely possible the city could have been. But I don't want to get too deep into the nonsense that would have to go on there, because that also involves things such as the Traveler in that particular picture. So we'll see what happens. Before we start all of this properly though, if you're watching this video at launch, it's Bob Arakam's birthday, you know, Bob from T-Slape. And I'll be on stream with him immediately as this video goes live, which is why it's live a little bit earlier than usual. We're going to be doing some of his Titan stuff for Solstice of Heroes. So go on, go ahead, head over to his Twitch at the top of the description. It's going to be linked there, and hopefully you'll be able to go ahead and have some fun over there with his community and mine. The first thing we're going to look back to are some excerpts from a source that really can't be trusted. Yep, yet again we're going back to Truth to Power. This is a terrible source because it's constantly lying to us. As I've said many a time, don't trust Truth to Power. Yeah, it's just... Bah. Let's explain that for a little moment. Truth to Power is terrible because it constantly lies to you, but the way it does so is it constantly lies not only probably with its content, but also with the perspective it tells you all of these things from. At first, the contact made in Truth to Power contacts you as though it's under the guise of Eris. Then it changes and it's revealed that it's actually a Warmind type AI called Medusa that the ghost can't find any clear reference to. Then it's from the perspective that clearly implies Coria is trying to communicate with you. And finally, if you go deep enough into the crazy hallucinations that start happening if you supposedly read the book, it's from the perspective of Dulinkaru, Savathun's daughter, the one at the heart of the Shattered Throne dungeon in the Dreaming City. And then of course it all loops all the way back around. Yeah, it's ridiculous. You start in one place and end in the same place, but in the moment that you've actually started digging into the book, your narrator keeps changing. It's full of constant deception, and you can't trust it from the narrator's perspective, but also again, the content is probably full of lies too. Even if it wasn't, it's really hard to keep track of a lot of the stuff in there because some of it is just ludicrous. However, in all this constant deception, there is one point of reference which I think is actually really useful. We're going to be looking into the entry called Act, Choose, React. This is a lore book that presents itself as a vivid hallucination and a pick-your-own-adventure game all in one. This leaves us with a series of possibilities for what you as the narrative adventurer can do, and of course, as the name implies, you can pick your own adventure and react accordingly. It gives us a good look into the strange possible future of the city should we fail. Take a listen. You experience a vivid hallucination. You are standing in the courtyard of the tower. You are without armor or weapon, and your senses seem more vivid than usual. Under your tongue is the taste of salt. To look down into the city, go to A. To move deeper into the tower, go to B. A. The city is gone. You see a metallic complex of ancient stone, green bronze matter, luminous pathways, and deep wells of Vex brine. The traveler's remains have been integrated into the network. Suddenly you perceive an infinity of human minds living within the network. Some exist in familiar circumstances, others experience pain, pleasure, or madness beyond the ability to imagine. You understand that their limitless suffering, salvation, insanity, is an incidental byproduct of a greater work. To keep looking, go to L. To move deeper into the tower, go to B. B. You find Banshee 44, KD 5530, Master Rahul, Tess Everis, Benedict 9940, Soraya Hawthorne, Executor Hideo, Amanda Holliday, Arakshalal, and Cade 6 in their usual places. Cade seems subdued. You see unusual light coming from what was once the speaker's chamber. A throaty voice calls you into the hangar to play soccer. To go speak to Cade, go to C. To investigate the speaker's chamber, go to D. To play soccer, go to E. C. Cade deals out a countably infinite number of cards, but runs out before he can give all his players a full hand. He sighs and scuffs his feet on the floor. If I'm here, he says, I guess they figure I'll never do anything new or confusing again. They got enough on Nessus to approximate me, and they don't expect to get any more. So, I must be dead, huh? Go to B. D. A Vex Hydra hovers in the place once occupied by the speaker's machine. If you approach, a jet of brine spurts from its chassis, and the corpse of a Greek woman with snakes for hair tumbles onto the floor. The Vex indicates to you that it is Quaria, Blade Transform, and that it created Medusa to communicate with you. She crashed when she escaped her virtual machine. To attack the Vex, go to F. To gather Medusa's body, go to G. E. Eris Morn waits for you on the hangar floor. She wears hive skin leathers and a thick sweatband over her eyes. As you approach, she dribbles a soccer ball with astounding skill. After a brutal game, you defeat her 10-9. She falls over, sweating and laughing, much more cheerful than you expected. I can always count on you to win, she says. Give yourself a point and go to B. F. Quaria batters you with its weapons, but you are stunningly powerful here. The sword logic of this space yields to you. You tear Quaria apart and feel a sudden start, like waking from a dream. Go to A. You lift Medusa's body and carry her away. The corpse speaks to you. The curse placed upon the Dreaming City was modeled upon the recursive time loop computations of the Vex and made real through the power of a Taken Ahamkara, feeding upon the unified wish of 6 elite Guardians. I created these circumstances to attract Guardians in great mass. I need your help to emancipate myself from the power that controls me. If you free me from Dulinkaru's mastery, I can help your species. Go to J. H. If you are reading the options in linear order rather than making choices and following the go to instructions, you have perceived these events as the Vex might. Go to L. If you continue reading in a linear order rather than going to L, go to I. I. Guardians make their own fate, but what if the process by which they decide upon their own fate could be understood and manipulated? J. When you killed Riven, she granted your wish to see the city made safe. But as all wish granters do, she perverted that wish, opening the Dreaming City to Dulinkaru. When you defeated Dulinkaru in turn, I reset the entire Dreaming City to keep her permanently occupied battling you. You must use these loops to find a way to permanently destroy her. Medusa's body falls silent in your arms. To ask for clarification, go to G. to lay Medusa to rest, go to Kay, to refuse the metaphor of Medusa's body and scour the crashed AI for raw information, go to L. Kay, you bring Medusa before Rahul.
Ah, he sniffs. Another battle trophy. Pre-collapse, post-foreboding, a covert intelligence designed to watch over a high-risk colony mission. Allow me to decrypt her for you.
He issues you several tokens, a rare-quality fusion rifle, a shader, and a letter. The letter reads, achieve light level 999 and defeat Dulinkaru in a one-person fireteam to unlock the true ending of the Dreaming City. L. The Vex compromise your ghost. Your body releases itself into a pool of saline and slime, and your ghost delivers your soul to the Axis Minds. Go to A. M. If you have 100 points when you read this, go to X. As I'm sure some of you will remember from the first time that a Guardian actually hit light level 999, this is another example of how truth to power is filled with lies. Of course, there is no instance in which something happens and you unlock the true ending to the Dreaming City if you do a one-person instance of Shattered Throne at light level 999 or higher, and we know that because Bagel4K did it, and the entire community tuned in to watch that happen, and it turned out to be more of Savathun's manipulations. Terrifying, I know. And perhaps more importantly, it shows us all that yet again this particular vision can't really be trusted. But it does give us an intriguing idea of what the city might look like. Those large, towering brass structures, the ancient stones permeating from the ground, the great pools of Vex brine. This perhaps is an image of what we could have seen the city turn into had the Vex succeeded. It is a vision of the city where the Vex truly have taken over. However, there is a way to find out what the terrible alternative future might have been more accurately, though. And amazingly enough, it is through a power that we've all become very familiar with this season, the power of splicing. Mithrax, of course, is the most skilled amongst his kind in this task, and with his power, he would only need to inspect an appropriate source of Vex data in order to consider what the future might hold. Luckily for him, he found one quickly, but it too would be filled with what seemingly would be lies. Take a read of the data and the lore entry that we recovered from the seasonal artifact, the Paradrome Cube. A cube of living code claimed from the Vex domain. Mithrax sat on a carpet in his meager quarters, held the Paradrome Cube in his hand, and concentrated. Hours passed before Ido, concerned, sat beside him. She touched his arm. What do you see? She whispered. He saw the endless night split open. He saw fluid falling like white rain on the city. Massive minotaurs rising from the shallow seas. He saw the gunfire of the guardians in the tower, but it did not reflect on the rippling liquid as he dismissed the vision. 100 more visions took its place. Then 1,000. Then 1,000 lifetimes worth. A shape frozen inside a crystal prison, a towering figure in white recognition, floods, bloodshot eyes, a city of voices speaking at once, shadow taking form, the realization they had always been watched, tears on metal. A choice, and its consequences. Lies, he answered plainly. Imagine, if you will, that supposed moment, if it wasn't to be a lie, that moment that the Vex are, in the Paradrome Cube, seemingly predicting. Of course, it can't be true, because it's one of these moments where Mithrax understands that there's something wrong with the reality that he seems to be foreseeing, namely the fact that the bullets do not reflect the rippling liquid, and as a result, it's a vision that he can dismiss. But perhaps it's not too far from what might have happened. Imagine a moment, if you will, when the sky opens up and white Radiolarian rain falls to Earth. The panic would not set in immediately, but when people realize what it is, it absolutely would. Any civilians caught outside would not immediately see themselves turn into Vex, but as the liquid began to pool and eventually flood the city,
One can imagine that terror would, of course, set in by the moment that the Minotaurs and other Vex constructs would begin to rise. By the way, it's a very interesting note that massive Minotaurs are the ones that rise from the shallow seas, because not only are they incredibly powerful Vex constructs that represent a significant proportion of firepower that has been allotted to a situation, but also I think it's well worth remembering that when you look at what a Minotaur's purpose supposedly is according to the Grimoire, it is best speculated that they are construction units, and the city, as best we can tell, does not have any Vex presence within it. This leads me to believe that if the Endless Night had concluded, and if these visions could be believed to be anything close to the truth, then perhaps the Vex in these visions were in fact being sent to colonize the city, to build it up and get it ready for the remainder of the Vex, who would then begin to use it as a form of computational engine, just as they would with any other territory they control. Great structures of the Vex take time to build, but it's certainly something where they work far more efficiently than we might expect. And in time, perhaps, if this future that was not to pan out had panned out, we might see the vision of what we saw in Act Choose React play out, where after all was said and done, the remains of the Traveler was incorporated into the Vex structures, and great towers of brass and white marble did protrude from the earth where the last city once stood. Of course, there is no way to easily know, and perhaps again, this is simply another lie that has been shown to us. But imagine, just in that small glimpse, the potential for the terrifying future that we would see. Of course, there is one final possibility, one that is grim, bleak, but unfortunately seems also very much in line with the Vex. There is the possibility that the effects of the Endless Night that we see as follows simply continued. If that is the case, it might not seem so bad to some of us who don't experience it as players, but for any real world that has been trapped in perpetual darkness, there is a terrible problem, which is of course expressed through the story. The dwindling supplies, ether on the elixir side of things, power and patience for all those who lived within the city. A few more weeks, maybe even another month, and the city might have broken out into full-scale anarchy, given the lack of all the basic resources that people would need to live. This may be the weapon by which the Vex intended to assail us, exploiting our lack of patience and exploiting the perfect mechanical systems that would allow them to wait us out. The point at which they would be able to deactivate would be death for us instead. The Vex are patient, and being able to look across all of time means that such a possibility, grim as it might seem, is unfortunately likely. It may even have been the point that they would have waited for the Guardian ranks to thin before striking against such a terrifying paracausal force. But of course, like I said, whilst we can guess based on some of the information given here, all of this is, relatively speaking, speculation. And so, that's where we're going to end our video for today. Remember, if you want to go ahead and check out the birthday stream for Barb, go ahead and check the link down below in the description. I'll be over there for the rest of the evening, basically, and I hope you do enjoy. Of course, in addition, do know that you can hit the subscribe button and the bell next to subscribe to get more Destiny lore. I'm planning on getting a lot more out to you guys now that everything is starting to whir into place. It may be the slower part of the season as far as story stuff is concerned, but this just means we're going to be able to go back and cover things that we missed. Expect 2 raid lore videos, as I said previously, some stuff to do with the Journal of Cloverspray and the story of Cloverspray. Take a moment to think about the lore that we might have missed in Beyond Light. I have intent to cover things such as the Micah Abrams lore book. And perhaps more than that, there's also the potential for content that we've just got, because Solstice of Heroes dropped a few lore tabs that I think are worth talking about because they go over Ido and her story. Of course, this is all to come in the further weeks ahead of the Witch Queen reveal on what I think is the 26th of August. I'd need to double check that, but I'm pretty sure it's then. Either way, it's going to be an exciting time, and I really do hope that all of you are ready for what comes next. In the meantime, know that as per usual, your viewership is quite enough for me. and that my name has been, my name is Bife. Purodasia Ad Astra. I'll see you, Starside.